The opening keynote address, the theme, the title of this keynote address is Economic Growth and Inequality. The speaker, as he mentioned just now, is Dr. Razeen Sali, Associate Professor at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy at the National University of Singapore. Before joining the Lee Kuan Yew School, Razeen Sali was on the faculty of the London School of Economics, where he also received his PhD. He remains the Director of the European Centre for International Political Economy, a global economy think tank in Brussels, which he co-founded in 2006. And Razeen has an extensive writing and research published on the WTO FTAs and on different aspects of trade policy in Asia. He has also written on the history of economic ideas, especially the theory of commercial policy. So, without any delay, can I welcome Razeen Sali.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First, thank you, CD, and thank you to the Foundation for inviting me for the third time to EFN and to give this this talk. And I'm also pleased to be here for Lion Rock Institute's 10th anniversary celebration. I can't think of a time when Lion Rock Institute is more needed than at the present time here in Hong Kong. Now, the title of our event is Liberalism, Promoting Growth, Reducing Inequality. And the title of my talk, in the narrow sense, is on economic growth and inequality. It, of course, raises the question, as economic liberals, should we be in the business of talking about inequality, especially in the sense of inequality of outcomes, distribution, as opposed to procedural equality, which is the kind of equality that classical liberals talk about. And both Bill Stacey and Siggy Herzog broached that theme. Now, of course, economic liberals are in the business of talking about promoting growth all around. But let me address this question about inequality, what we mean by it, and whether economic liberals, at a time when a certain type of inequality, that's to say income inequality, is widening, and in some parts of the world, not least in the city-states of Hong Kong and Singapore, that has widened considerably over the last decade plus, whether economic liberals have to face up to the distribution of issue as well, and if so, what should they do about it? That's my theme in the narrow sense, but as I was sitting down to write up this talk, I decided to put this in a much bigger picture, and the much bigger context for me is the state of capitalism in Asia today. And that will lead me to broach one or two other themes that also relate to the issue of inequality. Now, this is going to be an old-fashioned, rather 19th century or 20th century type of presentation. I do not have fancy slides and tables and charts. I only have a few simple bullet points. So it's going to be in the form of a narrative, more than anything else. So let me start by setting the overall scene of the state of capitalism in Asia, at least as I see it. And I use the word capitalism advisedly, very deliberately. Of course, by capitalism I mean the market economy, as we have understood it from Adam Smith onwards, that's to say, a system of relatively freely forming prices, underpinned by property rights, and of course a large degree of economic freedom. But the kind of capitalist system I'm going to talk about is very much the child of one of the great 20th century economists, Joseph Schumpeter. Schumpeter, as Americans call him, Schumpeter, as Austrians and Germans would call him. Now, Schumpeter wasn't the first to think about capitalism. The first major thinker to think about capitalism as a system, and in fact the first major thinker to mention the word capital, was of course Karl Marx. And Karl Marx did have a certain vision. Schumpeter liked to talk of visions. In other words, thinking of the broad system before getting down to technical details. Marx did have a vision of capitalism. Schumpeter thought that some of that was right and insightful, but some of it was dreadfully wrong. Schumpeter's vision of capitalism was rather different from Marx's. And it is a very optimistic vision. To begin with, capitalism is not a kind of neoclassical static equilibrium device. Capitalism is always on the move. It is a dynamic. There is really no such thing, apart from short snippets of time, when capitalism or the market economy is ever in equilibrium. Equilibrium in that sense doesn't matter. It's largely irrelevant. It's about a dynamic. And it's captured in Schumpeter's famous quote that capitalism is essentially a perennial gale of creative destruction. So new people, new entrepreneurs, new businesses swarm around new technology. Sometimes established businesses swarm around new inventions and technologies. And they destroy the old, the sluggish, the sclerotic. And so business cycles go back and forth. And there is enormous material progress as a result of this creative destruction, which is always happening. It never stops if the system is allowed to work. Now, at the heart of this system, which is not just an economic system, it's a great civilizational drama. The biggest drama, the most transforming drama that humankind has ever witnessed, not just in the economic sense, but also in transforming society and transforming political institutions. The engine of that, and Schumpeter used the term engine because of its dynamic connotation, the engine of it is this something called the entrepreneur. And the entrepreneur is not, in the narrow sense, a rational utility maximizing actor. He has all sorts of motives. He or she these days has a rather complex psychology. Money is part of it, but money is only one part of the motivation of the entrepreneur. And so wealth is created. But inevitably, at the heart of capitalism is inequality. Inequality in terms of process, of outcomes in particular. Because capitalism thrives on differences, not on sameness. And if one doesn't have that, one doesn't really have capitalism. So there, in a nutshell, is Schumpeter's vision of capitalism. It doesn't happen automatically. It requires an appropriate framework of policies and institutions, above all to keep the system open to this kind of creative destruction, of constant dynamic. So, that's capitalism in the abstract. What does it mean in practice, and what's happened in this part of the world in particular, before I get down to the narrow issue of growth and inequality? Well, let's take a look. Let's take a snapshot. Capitalism before the global financial crisis. Well, it had its greatest spurt, of course, after the Industrial Revolution in the long 19th century. It collapsed. It was completely destroyed between the two world wars. Post 1945, we saw capitalism first thriving in an Atlantic economy of Western Europe and North America, plus Japan and a few East Asian tigers. But of course, the real burst of capitalism that we've seen in recent times was roughly in the three decades, the 80s, the 90s, up until the global financial crisis, when most of the rest of the world, including the big developing countries, came on board. And we had the biggest burst of market liberalization and global integration the world has ever seen. I'm not going to go through the facts and figures here because they are, or they should be, pretty familiar. We've seen very high growth rates, an unprecedented reduction of poverty, and a massive increase in individual freedom and well-being, arguably, the biggest the world has ever seen. This has not happened by accident because it relates very much to a shift in policies, liberalization, markets, global integration, and corresponding with that, a shift of ideas, because this era also saw a revival of classical liberalism and, of course, its two greatest advocates at the time, going well beyond economics, were Milton Friedman and Friedrich von Hayek. So that's the past, which ended relatively recently with the GFC in 2007-2008. So what's happened since then? Well, we had a big crisis around the world in those years, just 6-7 years ago. A deep slump in output and employment. We see a continuing slow-burning crisis in the West, with anemic growth, with relatively high unemployment, with indebted governments, banks, and households. That continues and will continue for some time. We saw a fast rebound from the crisis outside the West in many emerging markets, particularly in Asia, but that has also slowed down considerably in the last couple of years, not least in China and India. And that also corresponds with a significant increase in debt, in overall levels of debt in the economies concerned, which is a product of policies that have taken place since the crisis. Now, what we've also seen in the wake of the GFC is a shift in the pendulum of policies. So we are back to an age of much greater state intervention in markets and more restrictions on markets and agents in markets. We see that in macroeconomic policies with more active fiscal policies, more active interventionist monetary policies. We see that in the microeconomic arena around the world, this is not just a phenomenon in the West, of governments intervening in the micro detail of markets, beginning with financial regulation and extending to, for example, cars and renewable energy in the West, to all sorts of industrial policies in China and elsewhere, wind power, high-speed rail, and so on. So that's just the flavor of this swing towards greater intervention. And that has also been accompanied, it's correlated, with a swing in the pendulum of ideas. So classical liberalism is weaker now around the world than it has been in some time. To begin with, it lacks its great propagators and promoters. We do not have the successors to Milton Friedman and Friedrich Hayek today. Armies of think tank bureaucrats in the United States, some of them very good, are not a substitute. And we have lots of academics and others who work in their narrow little furrows, but don't have that breadth of vision or that compelling delivery that that the greats of old had. That's a significant problem that I think will stay with us for a while. But it goes deeper than that. Let me address some of the symptoms. And I'll divide it between macroeconomic and microeconomic policy. And the two are related. On the macroeconomic front, we are back to another age of Keynes. And let me do a very brief historical back and forth here. If we go back to Keynes's original thesis in the general theory, prefigured in his earlier writings, it was very much about a Great Depression, a slump in output and employment, which left a structural deficit in aggregate demand, which government had to step into, had to artificially boost demand through monetary and especially fiscal policy in order to get an economy, indeed the world economy, out of this slump and onto a normal track. And this has been pretty much the playbook, not just in the West, but also outside the West. With governments, very much with the support of most macroeconomists around the world. We see that in fiscal policy, we see that in monetary policy. But it goes beyond that. Now, Schumpeter was one of the great interpreters of Keynes, and if you read Schumpeter's writings on Keynes, what you'll see is an argument that Keynes actually had a very pessimistic view of capitalism, very anti-Schumpeterian, well before the Great Depression. And Keynes's vision was of a capitalist system that was basically stuck not just in the short term, but in the long term, with something called secular stagnation. Savings were not being turned into investment and productive employment. Government had to intervene to boost those savings through boosting aggregate demand to get economies onto a higher growth track. And note, that very term, secular stagnation, is back, and it comes out of the mouth of Larry Summers. And other aspects of pessimism about capitalism, not just about the short term of it, but the longer term of it, are also back. We are now in a world where technology, so we are told, destroys rather than creates jobs. And we are in a world of increasing inequality. So that kind of pessimism of capitalism is back. It seems to enjoy a sort of majority semi-consensus among the experts. And that's something for those on our side of the fence to worry about. It is accompanied by a swing of the pendulum in microeconomic thinking as well. And this goes back to 20th century welfare economics, which starts with Keynes's teacher at Cambridge, A.C. Kigoo. The idea here, of course, is that there are market failures everywhere, and therefore it is the job of governments, who of course are disinterested, platonic guardians as it were, to intervene to fix those market failures on behalf of the public interest. And we see that kind of rationale in all kinds of microeconomic regulation, starting with financial markets around the world. Now, what unites this thinking as between macro and microeconomic policy is a social engineering mentality. It is the idea that a group of experts with public interest in mind and with relevant knowledge at hand, a committee to save and improve the world, as it were. Improving the state of the world is, by the way, the motto of the World Economic Forum, where this kind of thinking is very prevalent. That with these assumptions, these high-minded, smart people can intervene all the way from complex macroeconomic aggregates to the detail of what individuals and households and firms do, to make markets work better. Now, it is incumbent on us, who think differently, to point out that this is fundamentally wrong in micro as well as macroeconomic policy and in the broader functioning of institutions. It is wrong for at least three main reasons. Firstly, we do not have the relevant knowledge at our fingertips, as Hayek tells us, because most of the knowledge out there is not formal knowledge. It's all sorts of tacit and informal and constantly changing knowledge that no collective mind can have a grasp of. And when we intervene, invariably we end up with all sorts of unanticipated negative consequences. Secondly, interventions are rarely disinterested, as public choice economics, going all the way to Adam Smith, tells us. It is also very much about the self-interests of those who intervene, who are invariably some sort of elite. And thirdly, there is a strong moral argument. All of this offends the principle of economic freedom, the freedom of individuals in their daily lives as they go about their market activities. And Schumpeter, I think, would add, were he here today, that these kinds of interventions, both macro and microeconomic, gum up capitalism. They make capitalism less open. They make it semi-closed. They make it less open for agents, entrepreneurs, to constantly reinvent capitalism, to keep it dynamic, to create jobs and create wealth all around. And that relates to the issue of inequality, as I will come to in a moment. That's my broad scene-setting exercise. Let me now move on to the central issue of our conference, which is on growth and inequality. And let me state here now the view of the critics, as it were. And this view is that inequality is widening. By that they mean income inequality in particular. It's widening around the world. It's not exclusive to just a few countries in the world, in the West. It is a problem on both economic and political grounds, and something has to be done to fix it. Now, everybody, of course, mentions the French economist Thomas Piketty, not Thomas, it's Thomas Piketty, as the French say, and his mammoth book, Capital. I'm not going to dwell on that. I must confess I haven't read the book. I've read some of the reviews. There's just too much other stuff to read out there. The basic thesis he has is that the rate of return to capital, not just recently, but over the past 200 years at least in the West, has constantly outpaced the rate of growth of output. That's his measure of inequality. In the narrower sense, and what dominates the public debate, is the argument that the present state of technology and globalization has widened income differentials around the world, disproportionate returns going to the top 20 or 20%, 10 or 20%, who are educated, skilled, and professional, and own capital, while incomes for those at the bottom, and indeed those in the middle, have been stagnant, and in some cases have even declined at the bottom. And that this is not just economically unfair, but it also creates political problems, not least for the capitalist system, because it undermines support for the continuation of the system. What are the causes? Well, the causes are a combination of technology and globalization. Globalization has been unprecedented in the last few decades, before the crisis certainly, and this has led to increased competition, particularly with the phenomenon of the offshoring of jobs to cheaper locations. And then technology, particularly in its new wave of 3D printing, of supercomputers, of robotics, artificial intelligence, is, at least in the short term and maybe beyond that, destroying jobs, not just blue-collar jobs, but all sorts of white-collar jobs, extending into the reaches of the middle class. That the new companies are not employing as many people as the old companies. So that this new wave of creative destruction is worrying and increases inequality as between those at the top and those at the bottom and many of those in the middle. What about solutions? Well, the collectivists out there, whether they be hardcore socialists or milder social democrats, are very much in the business of advocating taxes and subsidies to fix this problem. Notice the engineering analogy, fix the problem. Now, I should add, by the way, that the diagnosis is not something that only comes from social democrats and socialists. It comes from some supposed economic liberals as well, such as the Economist newspaper, if the Economist newspaper can be considered liberal in the economic sense these days. I have my doubts about that. And it comes from the impeccable pen of one of the most prominent market economists, free market economists in the world, Tyler Powell, in a book called Average is Over. Now, their solution is somewhat different, and it's broadly sensible. It's about education and further liberalizing markets, particularly in services, where markets are more protected, where you have state-owned incumbents or private sector cronies prevented from competing with others. Let me offer a broad alternative diagnosis to this pretty pessimistic one about growth and inequality, and I'll do so in five short parts. Yes, there is wider income inequality around the world. Yes, it is a combination of technology and globalization. But it must be qualified heavily. And I'll do so in 5 points. The first is about global inequality. When we are talking about an increase of inequality, we are generally talking about an increase of inequality within countries. Not all countries, but in many countries, mainly in the West, but some outside the West as well, such as China, such as parts of Southeast Asia, such as the city-states of Hong Kong and Singapore, such as in India to a milder extent since the beginning of economic reforms in the early 90s, to a much milder extent in India. But global inequality, if you think of people around the world, has declined dramatically in the last two or three decades, very much as a consequence of markets and globalization that have lifted people out of poverty around the world, and notably in China and India. China and India had average incomes per capita per head that were only 20% of the global average in 1980. Now it's, or by 2020, they will be the global average. Surjit Bhalla says in a paper that global inequality today is at its lowest since 1850. Now that, to me, is far more important, a revolutionary development indeed, than any of the negative consequences we've seen in recent decades of an increase of inequality within countries. The fact that growth has lifted so many people out of poverty and delivered life chances to so many people around the world, and by the way, has reduced inequality around the world in that sense. Second point is I make one very briefly, developing countries in their phase of catch-up growth inevitably have more inequality to begin with, but it tends to plateau off. That's the thesis of another famous economist, a contemporary of Schumpeter, Simon Kuznets. The third point is about consumption. Because while income inequality may have increased in some parts of the world, we have seen huge benefits coming from purchasing power or consumption around the world in the last few decades, very much as a consequence of markets and globalization. Some of us were here at the Mont-Pelerin Society conference a couple of months ago. There was a paper given by Professor Don Woodrow of George Mason University, I think. And he did it very nicely. He showed us some slides from the Sears catalog, hard copy, 1975 in the United States, the cost of various items, household products. And he compared that with the same products in the Sears Roebuck or the Sears.com catalog, which you can get online in the United States today. And I'll just give you a few examples. The average worker in the United States earned $5 an hour in 1975. And with that level of earning, he could buy a coffee maker costing about $40. It would take him, 8 hours to buy a coffee maker, and the average American worker. Today, even though median incomes have been stagnant in the United States ever since, the average American worker only needs to work 50 minutes to afford their coffee maker, which now costs $16.99, not $40. He had to work 1 week to afford a TV set. Now he has to work one day to afford a much better TV set than the TV sets that existed in 1975. He has to work, he had to work 57 hours to afford a typewriter. No one uses typewriters anymore, except some octogenarian writers. But now he has to work 48 hours to afford a PC, which of course has many more functions than a typewriter. Now that's an American phenomenon, but it's a worldwide phenomenon and an Asian phenomenon as well. So in that sense, consumption, despite depressed incomes here and there, has benefited all, rich, poor, and those in the middle around the world. Fourth point is about education. Education, as Surjit Bhalla told us in the same paper, with the same presentation he gave at MPS, is a great equalizer. Because when you provide bigger access, broader access to education, it improves the average. In other words, the average is not over, as Tyler Cowen would have us believe. And it also reduces the gender gap, because it is about educating girls and young women as well. And that gender gap has reduced enormously, not least in India, as a result of education. My fifth and final and biggest point, contra the conventional diagnosis on inequality, is very much about the lack of innovation, which brings me back to Joseph Alois Schumpeter. The problem today is that we have a serious lack of innovation. Yes, we've had big innovations in quite a narrow bunch of technologies around IT and the high-tech companies. They have delivered enormous benefit in addition to a lot of frivolities. So as Peter Thiel, one of the founders of Facebook and PayPal, puts it, we haven't invented the flying car, but we have invented 140 characters, which leads to all sorts of frivolous activity on Twitter, Facebook, and what have you, which is why I intend not to spend too much time but that's a matter of choice, because I know some of you take a very different view. Tom's posts are worth reading, by the way. The problem is one has to go through all kinds of junk before getting to his posts. but I digress. The problem is that the innovations we've seen in the last two or three decades have been thin rather than broad. Compared with previous eras of innovation, they have actually spread their benefits far less. Innovations in the 19th century as well as after post-1945. And the problem here is that companies, including the big multinationals, they've got a bit lazy because they've had easy gains from globalization. We've had Smithian growth in the sense that markets have widened as a result of liberalization. So rich pickings for multinationals and consumers. But companies have not been on their toes in investing for innovation. R&D budgets are actually at historic lows when you compare them to all kinds of other things. Apple spends far more these days on lawyers than it does on R&D to defend its existing products. In that sense, Apple is not at the cutting edge of innovation. And so you have companies around the world who hoard cash, who invest that money safely, very much at the behest of pension funds, the heart of financial markets, but do not take risks in the Schumpeterian sense in innovating new products and getting them through to consumers. And that's abetted by government regulation, because government regulation is usually in the business of slowing down innovation and creative destruction to protect incumbents. Not just classic crony capitalists, but also a lot of the world's multinationals, who in some areas would prefer not to have competition. Companies rarely want competition, as Adam Smith told us a long time ago. So that combination of, as my colleague Frederick Erickson puts it from ESSAI, of corporate globalism and corporate socialism, abetted by governments, slows down innovation. And what happens when innovation slows down? Jobs aren't created. Wages are stagnant. They don't increase. And so, yes, inequality does widen. So what we need is actually much more innovation and more open systems, and that's also a case of getting back to markets, more liberalized markets, to create more jobs, more productive jobs, and also higher paying jobs. In that sense, I think the pessimism, the techno-pessimism of today is unwarranted. Inevitably, there are going to be short-term adjustments. But what history teaches us is that innovation, new technologies, do actually create jobs and employment and improve the average over time. It need not take that long. That's, I think, the answer. So to sum up this section on growth and inequality, let me put it this way. In terms of what I think would be a reasonably consistent economic liberal or classical liberal view on inequality. Economic liberals should not be in the business of targeting inequality in terms of ensuring certain outcomes. That is the business of the collectivist, the socialist or the social democrat, who thinks in terms of engineering a closed system with all kinds of false assumptions. What Hayek would call a fatal conceit, on knowledge, on public interest, and all that sort of thing. Economic liberals should be in the business of procedural justice, which is trying to ensure an equality of rights, of procedures, but to keep the system open, and the system then delivers results that we cannot predict in advance. So we do not engineer outcomes. And that is, I think, something we should stick to, despite all the phenomena and the complaints around us. That is not to say that widening income inequality is not a problem, something that we can simply ignore. Yes, if benefits are do not or are not shared by the broad majority, or indeed by large swathes of people in a society, that's a problem. It's an economic problem, it's a political problem as well. But the way to address it, I think, is very much a supply-side issue of opening up markets further. In other words, it's about competition. And that, I think, would broadly speaking be a consistent economic liberal view on this issue and indeed problem of growth and inequality. I have about 10 minutes, is that right? Okay. I wanted to broach just a couple of other points before wrapping things up. So let me return to the two big broad policy categories, macroeconomic policy and microeconomic policy. Now, as I was saying before, we see a huge increase of intervention on the macroeconomic front. I won't go through the details here, given the time constraint. But what we've seen is basically a swing away from rules, what rules we had, towards much more discretion. So with fiscal stimulus programs, with unorthodox monetary policy, extending to buying government bonds and even bonds in financial securities in financial markets, represents a huge increase in the discretion of regulators and policymakers. And we have to criticize that as something fundamentally flawed for two main reasons. The first reason is narrow and instrumental. It's that these policies have not worked and are unlikely to work. Fiscal stimulus programs in the United States and in Europe, and as we see now in Japan, have not worked for all kinds of narrow technical reasons and beyond. Monetary expansion, loose monetary policies, resulting in the vast increase of the balance sheets of central banks, has also not worked in the United States and in Europe, and now indeed in Japan. It might have delivered a modest boost, but very modest. But we should point out all the costs involved. Fiscal stimulus programs result in a huge increase in public debt, and they raise the specter of inflation sooner or later, because the temptation, of course, is to inflate one's way out of paying off that debt, or indeed loading it onto taxpayers directly. Monetary stimulus in the way that we've seen it is also about inequality, as is inflation, because the benefits have gone hugely to people with assets already in capital markets, at the expense of small savers, arguably. It's caused problems for emerging markets. It's led, for example, the authorities here in Hong Kong and in Singapore and indeed in Switzerland to engage in all kinds of exchange rates and all sorts of other things. More fundamentally, monetary policy and central bankers now seem to be in the business of fiscal policy and all kinds of distributional policies, and that's not their business. They're not equipped to do this. So there are all kinds of narrow technical reasons why these macroeconomic policies should be criticized, but more fundamentally, they should be criticized on constitutional grounds. Because as an economic liberals, we should be arguing for both macro and microeconomic policies that are about clear, simple, transparent, predictable rules, so that we have some kind of stable framework within which the hurly-burly of markets can unfold, can flourish. And that should apply to fiscal and monetary policy as well. Gladstonian public finance was very much the order of the day in the 19th century. And Milton Friedman always advocated stable, steady monetary policies. Different versions of this exist. So there are economic liberals who are more on the libertarian side. There are others who prefer independent central banks and inflation targeting according to set rules. Those are details, but I think in terms of the broad compass, it's important to point out that the current trend of policies in macroeconomic policy is wrong because it is all about discretion with lots of false assumptions attached and a departure from clear, simple, stable, predictable rules. And the same, I think, applies to microeconomic policy and the vast increase of interventions we've seen around the world in both product and factor markets. My last point is really about institutions, and a lot of what I've said leads to the issue of institutions, how economic liberals should view institutions, and how it's playing out in different parts of Asia. By institutions, I mean the decision-making framework for markets, all the way from the rule of law for public administration to the way regulatory agencies function. Now, of course, we have huge institutional variety all over Asia. Institutional quality is generally better in high-income countries, middling in middle-income countries, and much worse in low-income and least developed countries. But let me make a broad point here. If you are a poor country, which is the case of the countries of South Asia and some of the countries in Southeast Asia, you can actually get by with institutions that function badly, corruption, authoritarianism, lots of crony capitalism, providing you mobilize resources, labor, land, and capital for high catch-up growth. But when you exhaust your catch-up growth, and when your growth depends more on, yes, productivity and innovation, you need to improve your institutional quality. The rule of law, public administration, independent regulatory agencies, and so on. And this raises the issue, if I might just have a few more minutes, of what the authors James Robinson and Darren Acemoglu call inclusive and exclusive institutions. It's a reformulation of an age-old issue. Inclusive institutions are about liberal democratic politics as a way of ensuring competitive markets. Access is broad. Exclusive institutions are about very limited access to a narrow elite of insiders. And that leads to problems in the marketplace because what they do is they extract rents in the market and they keep competition out. This becomes much more of an issue at higher levels of development when innovation is the order of the day. So, in the high income and the middle income countries in Asia, politics and economics become much, much more entwined. And it's important to move towards more inclusive institutions politically, not just in terms of more democracy in a very casual sense, but also liberalism, ensuring individual rights and checks and balances, very much in the spirit of the Federalist Papers of Madison and Hamilton. Not only because that's important in and of itself, but because it's important for competition in markets and for the survival and the flourishing of economic freedom. Because then a society is open, and it's open to innovation, the kind of capitalism that Schumpeter advocated. Let me put it in another and more concrete way. China is never going to be anything other than a copying society. It will never be an innovative society with its present political system. There is a basic contradiction between Mao and markets, right at the heart of the reforms that Xi Jinping advertises. Because you probably cannot, beyond the short term, really have more markets in China using the instruments of Mao in politics and economics. And China is inevitably going to face increasing tensions between a somewhat dynamic economic system and a static political system. We have problems even in Japan, Korea, and Taiwan. With institutions that have simply not kept up with the pace of development and which hold innovation back. We have problems in Southeast Asia, not least with the more advanced countries of Thailand and Malaysia, where institutions are basically bringing growth gradually to some kind of halt. And then finally, let me come to the city-states of Hong Kong and Singapore, where we are really at a crucial juncture here. These are both great success stories, although there is a myth, about, especially about Hong Kong, that Hong Kong has really been a laissez-faire state. Relatively speaking, perhaps, but Hong Kong has never been a laissez-faire state. And now, I see this in Singapore as well as Hong Kong, we have institutions in these global cities, which is a bracket in and of itself, that prevent further innovation from taking place. Let me give you the example of Singapore. Singapore has capitalism that is successful by international standards, but it's still rather bureaucratic and started by capitalism. It lacks innovation. And it leads back to the political system, because the political system dominated by insiders ensures that the domestic economy is largely dominated by government-linked corporations and sovereign wealth funds. And the price paid is that Singapore lacks a dynamic domestic private sector, SMEs. And innovation is really cramped. You probably need to open up the political system in Singapore, more competition there, in order to bring about more competition in markets, even though there are going to be social democratic temptations along the way. And broadly speaking, that would be my take on Hong Kong as well. It is unlikely that Hong Kong is going to be a more innovative society, and indeed be a flourishing global city, when its present political system leads to the gradual erosion of its institutions in a much more illiberal direction. And that is why I think those students out there deserve at least some sympathy. They may not be arguing about this directly, but it is part of the package. Those are just some of the big issues that I wanted to broach. Let me conclude very quickly. I think there's good news and bad news. The good news is, if we look at a very long historical sweep and say compare our situation today with that a century ago in 1914, just as World War I broke out, we have reasons to be very optimistic. The world is much wealthier, ordinary people are much better off, and have much better life chances. They have more economic freedom, among other things. Institutions are much more mature, broadly speaking. Geopolitics is a problem, not least in this part of the world, but it's not nearly as bad as it was a century ago. Interest groups are a problem, but they're not nearly as damaging as the protectionists were a century ago. We have anti-market ideas out there today, as we have always had, but they're not as noxious as the collectivist ideologies of a century ago. Those are the reasons to be optimistic around the world and also in Asia. The bad news is that in the short term, the pendulum has swung in the wrong direction, in policies as well as in ideas, and it is up to us to put forth the counter view of simple, clear rules in all aspects of policy, not making a distinction between macroeconomics and microeconomics, whether it's Abenomics in China, or what's happening in Japan, or what's happening in China, or elsewhere, for competition and innovation to bring about a revival of the kind of capitalism that delivers what works and where freedom works. Thank you.